In 1987, Eli Lilly came out with a revolutionary medication. At least it really changed the way psychiatry was practiced and actually a lot of medicine in general. And that was, of course, Prozac, the first kind of the SSRI medications. Now we have a whole bunch of different ones of the same class: Zoloft, Celexa, fluoxetine, sertraline. And these medicines have become really the mainstay for treating depression. Not only depression, but anxiety and obsessive compulsive disorder as well. They generally have low side effects, they have pretty good responses, and we've had a lot of experience with them. 2004, the FDA came out with the black box warning for the potential for increased suicidal ideation, which just means increased suicidal thoughts in adolescents and in children. And this really curbed the prescribing for a little while and had its own downside. Today, I kind of want to talk a little bit about the importance of informed consent, that is, having these conversations with families and with patients. And as if you are a family or a patient, I hope this is helpful for you as well. But also to sort of help you better be comfortable with the medicine yourself, because there are very, very good reasons for us to be using it. Back to the idea of informed consent. You know, it's really important that we as clinicians do a good job of telling patients risks and benefits. And the thing is, there's a risk and a benefit to most things, or at least most things that are good for us. If you think about it, even exercise, take running. We know the benefit. The benefit is it can help us cardiovascularly, help our heart, help our lungs, help our general health. But it can also lead to injury. It can lead to shin splints. It can lead to, well, I mean, even if you try it too quickly, too fast, push yourself the wrong way, potentially cardiovascular issues like a heart attack. There are risks to running, but there are also great benefits. So what we do is we weigh the risk and we weigh the benefit and we do what we can to make the risk less likely. We call it mitigating the risk. And then we decide, well, if the benefit's better than the risk, we should go for it. Well, the same is true with medicine, the same is true with surgery, same is true with anything like this. So it's important to understand that there's definitely a benefit that we're hoping to achieve, or we wouldn't even suggest the medication in the first place. But you also need to know that there's a risk. And so for the clinicians, it can be a challenging thing to have to talk about this, because we're kind of afraid of, what are they going to think? Is the patient going to want to take the medication? Is it going to scare them off of the medication? And the reality is, if you are just well-informed and are able to tell the patient the things that I tell them, they generally are fine with it. And this is why. There was a big study called the TADS study, which is the Treatment for Adolescents with Depression study. And it pretty much demonstrated that Prozac was about 61% effective in the study versus 35% effective for placebo. Now, that's actually sugar pills. When you think about it, a third of the people took a sugar pill and still felt better. But it was double that in the case of people who actually got the Prozac. So we know that the Prozac was very effective for relieving depression. And as we say now, it may even be more effective for anxiety and obsessive compulsive disorder. And so as a result, we have good evidence that it works in young people and children. However, as I said, in 2004, the FDA was looking over numbers and there was this, what they call a signal in the data that made it appear or suggested that people under the age of 18 might be more likely to have suicidal thinking when taking these medications. And after they sifted through a lot of the studies, which is what they did, they came to the conclusion that there was about a 2% increase above placebo, which means that 2-4% of people given this medication would have suicidal ideation, which was just a little bit or 2% more likely than placebo. So a little bit more likely than placebo, but it was real. I mean, we now know that certain people can have this particular reaction. Now, interestingly, of over 4,400 kids in the research that was looked at, there were no completed suicides at all. And that's important to remember, because the idea of suicidal thinking is not the same as committing suicide. And so we have to take that into consideration. Now, interestingly, in 2006, the FDA actually raised the age of risk to 25. So basically my entire population, for the most part, most of my patients are between the ages of, you know, 10 and 25. I have plenty on either side as well, but I have this conversation a lot because they fit right into that category. So ever since that black box warning, we've had to be a little bit more diligent in our talking about risks and benefits. But here's an interesting fact. So following the black box warning, anti-prescription or antidepressant prescription rates actually decreased about 18 to 20%, according to a study by Nemiroff in 2007. And in that same year, the rate of suicide in youth actually increased 18%. Now, that was actually under 20 years old. We went down in about 18 to 20% in our prescriptions because we were afraid of the black box warning, and the number of suicides went up by an equal amount. Now, there's no way we can establish causation, meaning saying for sure that one caused the other, but it's something that we're all aware of, that when we stopped prescribing them, suicide rates went up. And that's really important for us to think about. There was another study in 2014, or a review actually, that showed that the prescribing of antidepressants in youth dropped around 30%, and that the increase of intentional suicidal ingestion or overdose attempts went up by about 22%. So once again, a lot of evidence out there that when we stopped treating, we actually had worse results. And that's kind of the final big picture lesson that I want to kind of convey, is that being depressed has a lot higher risk for suicidal ideation or thoughts than treating the depression with an SSRI. So this is pretty much the conclusion that most of us have come to. Evidence shows that that's the best approach at this point. So if we've decided that treatment is the option, and the SSRI is the first line of treatment, and as a matter of fact, this black box warning applies to other antidepressants as well, then we need to be ready to talk about it. So basically, this is how I have the conversation with my patients and their families. I won't go into the benefit, we've already talked about that. But basically I say, so I want to start you on an SSRI medication, and we've talked about what I'm hoping it'll do for you and how it will help. And one thing to keep in mind is not to expect anything beneficial for 4 to 5 weeks. It really takes 4 to 6 weeks for these medications to kick in. Interestingly, side effects will often be much earlier. So if you're feeling something right away, it's more likely a side effect, and we're going to talk about that. But the benefit, you know, really does take 4 to 6 weeks, so stick with it unless we have one of these side effects, and then we'll talk about it. But the most common side effects are headaches, stomach aches, some nausea, maybe some diarrhea. Interestingly, there are more serotonin receptors in our gut than there are in our brain, which is probably why the gut's so affected early on in treatment a lot of times. But these things usually pass. They usually go away on their own after about 4 or 5 days. So if you have a little headache, a little dizziness, little stomach ache, usually 4 or 5 days, they're gone. The other thing that's pretty common is a little bit of restlessness, maybe even a little bit of increase in your anxiety for a short period of time, but that also can be the medicine, so we kind of stick through that because that also goes away. Now, the bigger things that I worry about are mania or activation. So if there's bipolar history in your family, we do have to watch because you could develop into a manic episode. We know that these medicines can cause that if we're not careful. I'm not worried about that in the case of anybody who I'm treating for just basic depression, anxiety, or OCD. Finally, and most families, you're probably aware of this, know that there's a black box warning, which means the FDA has to make sure that we tell you that there's a possibility that it can actually increase suicidal thinking in young people. Now, here's what we know about this. I've been doing this for a while. About 1 to 2 in 100 of my patients, any patients, will tell you, yes, indeed, I've had some thoughts I didn't have before, or my suicidal thinking has gotten a little bit worse. Because they're telling us, because we are checking with them, because you're now aware of it, we've never had anybody actually complete suicide that we know of as a result of the medication. And that's what the studies have shown us as well. Actually, we know it sooner and are able to do something about it. If you were to develop these thoughts, I'd want to know about it. We stop the medicine. They go away, we try something else. But keep in mind, the goal is to make you feel better. And we're monitoring. And that's the main thing that we know will help keep you safe and everybody else safe as well. I think in conclusion, and I often tell the parents this as well, or the child this as well, you are 11 times more likely to get benefit from the medication than you are to suffer the rare side effect of having the suicidal ideation. So, you know, fear of a very rare circumstance, which has not led to any clear cases of completed suicide, versus the benefit we get from these medicines, easily outweighs the risk. And that's why we use them.